Testing 1, 2, 3. Can anybody hear me? Hey, folks, this is That Masked Guy from the Captain Fizz Masked Guy show. We're trying out some new stuff here, so you know what? We're going to get right in on the show. We don't actually have any music today.
No, we are testing a brand new mic on the wonderful, magical computer.
The computer, yeah, we've upgraded a little bit. But we've downgraded in the music department.
Yes, we are not in the music. We have music, it's just not currently on my computer, which really kind of sucks, but you have us. So it's the Captain Fizz and Mask Guy show, and I am, of course, Captain Fizz.
And, of course, I am the previous mentioned Mask Guy. Simply call me Loco if you like.
Yeah, so over the weekend we have attended C4 Comic-Con in Winnipeg. And honestly, it was phenomenal. If you've been following us on Twitter, which I know you all have, we've been posting tons and tons of pictures. And by we, I mean me. I went a little crazy.
You went. I did. I went off. I posted a few pictures myself. And then went off and posted pretty much everything on Instagram. There was a couple I chose not to just because of the quality of some of them. But hey, you know, I mean, we'll go off. We'll give you all that information near the end of the show.
Yeah, no, you know, honestly, it was a phenomenal. It was very unique to be able to see a lot of people dressed up as characters, and these are guys who've been there for almost every Comic-Con that we can remember. You know, we had one guy there. He's always dressed up as a Mandalorian. I'm not gonna, you know, say anything because honestly, I usually get which one of them, you know, they are is wrong. I actually spent the entire Comic-Con trying to find them, and I kept finding the same stupid Mandalorian.
There's quite a few Mandalorian.
There were 16 of them.
And you actually got a picture of them.
I got a picture of a few of them. I got a picture of all of them. You know how hard it is to track down one stupid Mandalorian when there are 16 of them running around?
Yeah, no kidding, eh? Yeah,
they all look alike.
Exactly. It was a pretty good, you know, event, I think.
You know, it was definitely like if you've ever been to Comic-Cons in other cities, for example, I've been to the one in Edmonton. And you know, the one in Edmonton is definitely acquired taste. It wasn't a bad experience, but $50 just to walk in. And, you know, not to mention, like, you got one floor. You know, you don't have a lot of guests. You don't have a lot of experiences. It just really was not worth the money. Now, the C4 here in Winnipeg, it cost me $20 to get in.
$20 for one day. I mean, let's face it. I mean, if I remember correctly, to get a three-day pass for, you know, the complete convention was less than $50.
Yeah,
so,
which is phenomenal. And basically, $20 and you have three floors of, you know, special, you know, events and comics and all these humongous things that you wouldn't actually believe. One floor just for the artists. So you were meeting a whole bunch of different artists. They were selling stuff. And it was very, I don't know, unbelievable experience.
Yeah, it was. I mean, there was so much going on. I mean, they had a whole room just for gaming, which we're not surprised by. I mean, but just, I mean, a whole room just for video gaming, and then another room for board gaming. And then, of course, I mean, you have, you know, the main exhibit and everything with all of the celebrities that were there. I mean, it's amazing. From someone who's attended, you know, C4 almost every year since its second year, I'm just amazed at how big this event has grown.
Yeah, it definitely went from, you know, being mediocre to being explosive. And the guests, like, I know you were very excited for some of them. I kind of find it a very lackluster, you know, guest lineup this year.
It wasn't as big as it's been in the past, but I'm not really complaining. Sylvester McCoy, I was a huge fan, particularly of him as Radagast the Brown from the Hobbit movies. And, of course, he was one of the doctors from Doctor Who that I watched as a young boy. So I was thrilled that he was there. I know my wife got Rob Van Dam's autograph for our son. as well. And I got the autographs of all of the celebrities that were there that were from Star Wars movies, including the actor who, not only, I didn't realize this, but not only did he do the voice and the puppetry for General Akbar, but he's also performed, did a couple things. He for a couple of the characters from Jabba's Palace in Return of the Jedi as well. And he also performed Howard the Duck from
whoa,
the movie.
Whoa. You mean he didn't come as Howard the Duck?
He didn't come as Howard the Duck.
So, you know, I looked at all the bio of all these characters, and not once did they mention Howard the Duck. Now, if they had mentioned in the bios that this guy had been Howard the Duck, I would have been all fanboy crazy. Howard the Duck, honestly, was one of the most phenomenal movies that I have ever seen. Well, one of them.
It was, honestly, I know Howard the Duck kind of gets mocked quite a bit, but you know what? I thought it was a very entertaining movie when I was younger.
I'm sorry. There's so many more movies I can mock, like Twilight. I'm sorry. A gay, sparkly vampire is less important than a talking duck.
Where's Buffy the Vampire Slayer when you need her?
I know. I don't even think she would touch that.
I don't know, considering that she was, you know, I mean, let's face it. Angel and Spike were about 10 times more masculine than any of the vampires that you saw in the Twilight saga.
Yeah,
I wouldn't call them, you know, I mean, at points, you know, you're thinking, you know, these guys, I mean, come on, vampires with souls? Come on, man. But, I mean,
I have to say there's one very good thing about the C4 is no one dressed up as Twilight. Thank freaking God.
It'd be kind of hard to go off and to pull that off because you'd be walking around as, you know, and no one really know that you're being like Edward or...
See, the thing though is, like, quite a few years back in Toronto, they actually had the entire cast of Twilight at their comic convention. Now, everybody went fangirl, fanboy, you know, crazy on that one. And I sat there and thought, thank God I'm not in Toronto. you know, I understand the reasoning for it, but Twilight, you know, yes, it was a book, but it was never a comic book. It should not belong in a comic convention. And I just don't understand it.
It's sort of in, you know, the sci-fi fantasy genre, though, because it... I mean, it's technically about vampires.
Okay, first of all, to enjoy a book like that, and I know a lot of people are going to hate me for saying this, but you would have to be extremely drunk to understand the complete stupidity of a vampire falling in love with a human and not killing them.
Yeah, I don't really understand. I mean, Stephanie Myers has went off and, I mean, hey, she somehow went off. Has made a boatload of money, you know, off of this. So, you know what? I, you know, tip my mask to her because, honestly, you know, as a struggling writer, I can appreciate, you know, when someone goes off and finds something that, you know, the fans attach onto.
She feminized a blood-sucking vampire.
Oh, no kidding. I mean, come on. I mean, it's... For anyone who would go off and complain about what Joss Whedon did with vampires and Buffy the Vampire Slayer... And for those people who do, shame on you. You know, I mean, this just takes it to a whole completely different level. And unfortunately, I kind of blame this show for stuff like The Vampire Diaries.
And
a lesser degree to True Blood.
And Warm Body.
And, well, yeah, Warm Bodies. I mean, that wasn't a half-bad movie.
I'm sorry, a human falling in love with a zombie. Just as but as twisted as a human falling in love with a vampire. It just does not logically make sense.
Well, I mean, come on. Again, I mean, I think we discussed this, I think, last week. We're not necessarily the demographic that they were going after for, you know, for when they came out with not just these movies, but the books that they were based off of.
You know what? I don't care that I'm not in the demographic. Okay, I grew up with Harry Potter. Now, there's a true book. You know, a classic, well-written, well-acted book/movie. Shut up.
Absolutely. No, I could... No. You know what? I'm willing to let that slide because I completely agree. I actually read The Deathly Hallows in one day. I literally... I just kept reading and reading it. I would stop long enough to eat, and then I would tell everyone to go away, and I would continue reading it.
Yeah, and, you know, honestly, it was one of my favorite series, next to, of course, Goosebumps, but that's a whole different storyline. But, okay, obviously, with Comic-Con, the big thing isn't even the guests, it's the people that attend and what they dress up as. And there was definitely a lot that stood out to me this year, and I think there probably was a lot for you as well.
You know, one of my favorite moments was, there was a DJ that was there, was playing music. And as I was walking by, a couple of women dressed up as Deadpool were dancing. And I actually took a picture of that. You could go off, you can check that out on not just my Twitter, at ThatMaskGuy, and of course, at FizzMashShow. It's also on Instagram, Fizz and MashShow.
The funny thing about that DJ, though, is for a while there, every time I passed him, he put a theme music for me, and it kind of sucked. I don't like theme music. It makes me think I have to do something exciting.
Well, I don't know. I mean, it was, I thought it was pretty entertaining. I know at one point, there was a ton of ladies that were all dressed up in costume going off and dancing over there. There was just
Then there was also a ton of guys who were picking their jaws up off the floor.
Well, yes, no kidding. Another thing that I liked was they had a group of girls who were dressed up as, you know, superheroines, but it looked like they were from, like, the 1940s, you know, in costume. And I thought, geez, that's a really nice. I mean, they looked, you know, very, you know, time appropriate for that age. And just, I mean, everything, I was just absolutely blown away by it.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, there was a lot of costumes. Comic-Con is definitely not an age-biased event. My favorite one, and actually, you know, I'm not a big fan of the game it's based off of, but a little boy was dressed up as a Minecraft character. You know, all the blocks. And the amount of detail and energy that would go into a costume like that is absolutely unbelievable.
Absolutely. Actually, there was a guy there who was an adult who was dressed up as the main character from Minecraft. And this isn't the first time I've seen him. I think he comes almost every year. I thought, you know, I mean, to some degree, I felt kind of left out. I mean, this is in the past, I have dressed up as a Jedi. I didn't this year because we were trying to, you know, a certain degree to advertise for the show wearing our Captain Fizz and Mask Guy t-shirts.
Which definitely got a lot of attention.
It did. We got a few questions about that. Hopefully, you know, we picked up a couple of viewers for our Twitter account from that.
You know, I have to call back some of the costumes. Absolutely. I honestly think a lot of them were phenomenal. There was one woman there I had the pleasure of talking to. She dressed up as Sally from Nightmare Before Christmas.
Oh, and that was good.
2 to 3 hours it takes her to do her makeup. If you're on Twitter, and, you know, we'll put our tags later that you can follow us, her picture is on there. It is honestly the most unbelievable makeup job I have ever seen. Completely flawless. She dressed up as Sally Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. That's 3 hours every day just to dress up as this character. You know, and some of these guys, you know, especially the Mandalorians, these isn't just, you know, a spur-of-the-moment decision. This is a year-long thing for them. You know, they travel around the whole country. They travel down to the States, dresses these Mandalorians for special events. You know, this is pretty much their livelihood. This is what they enjoy. And, you know, my favorite moment, you know, we always have that one favorite moment. And our first Comic-Con together with the little boy in the wheelchair.
That was
it's been topped.
I have to go back and see if I can find some of those old pictures and post them.
I think that moment has officially been topped. The little girl riding around in the Millennium Falcon. You know, with the music playing. And,
that was pretty cool.
You know, honestly, Comic-Con knows no age, and I think she was maybe 3 years old